and an socio-political activist. My observation is that Indian society, civic society, is very sharp, quite alert. We are, by tradition, we have an argumentative tradition,
yes,
scholar tradition. All our epics are argumentative. So that's no problem. The problem lies in the fact that the present, past about 30 years, past, the judgments have been very confusing. And concepts like decriminalization of offense, all these things have confused the common man quite a bit. And so they have lost faith in themselves, their own common sense. Jurisprudential common sense is quite prevalent, but we can't confront the courts. Like when they make comments like in their judgment, like the victim of the rape victim, soul is tarnished. We get into problems of contempt of court, contempt of judiciary. We can confront the politicians somehow or the other, but not judiciary.
Correct.
So I'm afraid I'll have to say that the judges should not be culturally biased. That's
exactly,
right.
Exactly.
But they should be culturally sensitive. It's very necessary that they are sensitive. Our old saying is apaurushair api vak prapanchaihi. It should not be personal, but it should be sensible, sensitive and sensible. So, no, I mean sensible, it should be sensitive. Sorry. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Second question. Where?
Thank you. So I really enjoyed the lecture. It was very cogent. Thank you very much for that. I do have a few questions. When you brought up the issue of independence of the judiciary and spoke about the different kinds of independence that are required, you seem to indicate that impartiality and diversity are also necessary components
Absolutely.
Of independence. But that, in that one part, you seem to almost imagine the judiciary and the collegium in specific as a monolith, disregarding the diversity of interest that may exist within the collegium as well, which, you know, they might pull in different directions at the same time. And as to how do we get this diversity, well, one, we could go for the structural reform route, which is what the NGAC is and which is what you're advocating. One other possibility is that of vigilance from civil society and from the political classes and criticism of the judiciary. After all, the judiciary itself, we have seen in the past, is not immune to criticism. It does seek to reflect the popular opinion, whether it is of television channels at night and what they say and that finding mention in judgments the next day or so on. So one possibility is to keep reminding the judiciary that there are far too too few women, far too few Dalits, that there are people accused of corruption who are finding their way into the judiciary, into the higher judiciary even. And why don't we see more of this coming from civil society? Why do we defer so greatly to the Supreme Court? And lastly, on social philosophy, I think it's a very strong point, and we have seen an even pro-corporate judiciary all through the 90s and through the 2000s, I would say, and so it is of great concern. But giving an example of a social issue, I'm not sure helps the case, because after all, socially the demos might not be very liberal on issues like sexual rights. So when we start questioning the social philosophies of judges and try to say that those who reflect our social philosophy should get into the judiciary, then that might not achieve the kinds of results that that the more liberal of us might actually want.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. So my question is, before the judgment was reserved, some of the criticism, some of our discussions were along the lines of, let us say the NJAC survives. What is the NJAC going to do different from the collegium? Because there was, so my point comes from the fact that in the absence of a performance commission, how much can an appointments commission do? And in the event, now that the NJAC has been struck down and say 20 years later or 10 years later, an NJAC, a new legislation is to come about, is it enough to only fix the ratio of judicial say with civil society and executive say, or is there a need for greater accountability even that appointment system itself? For instance, we do not know how many judgments of a particular high court judge are being struck down by the Supreme Court. We have no way of really assessing the performance of a member of the higher judiciary. And that's on the one hand, sir. On the second hand, the NJAC judgment itself, doesn't it in some way fall prey to its own logic? That the assumption, the underlying assumption is that pliant judges will be appointed by the executive. Won't that hold true even for the collegium, where judges of high courts will probably want to be in compliance and pliant to the collegium itself?
Yes,
of course. So aren't we moving in circles?
Yes, of course. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, sir, for a very interesting talk. And I think what I particularly appreciated was you were very candid and you put it also in a political context. So I'm just trying to reflect. I think you're right to say this was a real missed opportunity. I mean, this was a once in a generation opportunity to change a system, which I think if you would, when the amendment was passed, there was a rare consensus, not just in the political class, but also in civil society, in the academic sort of community, that this was a good thing, that this, whatever be the NJAC, the collegium system had to go. But I find I'm myself a little, I think I take your, you know, dissembling of the entire judgment, and I'm persuaded by your critique and by several other critiques. But I'm still holding back, and I'm trying to understand it. I think you said very interestingly that human nature, one must take account of human nature. And these are big constitutional issues. We must address them thinking of the long-term future. But our particular context does affect it, and that's inevitable. In your basic structure piece, you argued convincingly that when basic structure, the case came out, almost everybody denounced it. But over a period of time, it has come to be accepted, perhaps because of the political context of the personalities involved. So my point, and coming to it, is the reason there are some of us who are willing to not condemn this judgment as much as we would have otherwise is because of the political context. And you're right to say that the government of the day mustn't make a difference. But the point that you made from Justice Lokur's judgment, I thought that was a very revealing passage. When the judge says, what would this particular dispensation do?
That's right.
Mm-hmm. So, I mean, let's not forget there was the Gopal Subramaniam episode. That's amongst the first acts of this government. And that within the judiciary itself, there was a fear. And I think within civil society also, there was a certain concern about the kind of people who will be appointed to the judiciary. Now, let's look at other cases. Let's look at this cabinet and the way, the kind of people who are in positions of authority, how they are, even if there are some people who want to take decisions, how the Prime Minister's office controls it. Let's look at appointments made to the FTII or the Indian Council of Historical Research. By themselves, these are not, these institutions are very important for people in those industries, but we've seen the caliber of appointees there. I think all those factors perhaps account for why someone like me, I think this is not an ADM Jabalpur. And if you're going to say that the NJAC is as dangerous as that. Legally speaking, I think you've tried to explain to us why there could be perhaps as many blunders of logic, of reasoning. But I think that's what's holding people back. And I think people recognize that there is a lot at stake. And this judgment is... But the judges have very shrewdly tapped into that larger sort of concern. Mm-hmm. As someone who wants the judiciary to be reformed, I think if they continue with this charade and the circus that is going on, I think they will lose support more rapidly. And in a way, I feel like just let them do this until the ridiculousness of it comes out. And then they will sort of, this bench will implode or somebody will come up with that. But I'm just trying to explain to you why I think some of us are a bit careful in holding back, because we buy into that larger concern around us. And perhaps, as you're absolutely right, we should be thinking constitutionally and thinking of the future. But we are using our temporal concerns to yes. perhaps hold back our fire.
I'm not trying to belittle the issue. I'm not trying to say that these are not deep constitutional issues. If we just look at it as a pure recruitment problem, whether you're recruiting domestic help or the next CEO for Amazon.com, right? There are a bunch of factors you will use. If you had the right to make those choices, if you had the right to make a bunch of factors that you would choose, that you would look at these 28 resumes of potential lawyers who could be elevated or potential justices who would be brought to the Supreme Court, what would those factors be?
Right. I get your point, and I'll... Do we answer these questions now together, or are you taking any more, or...
You're
done.
It's already inside.
Yeah. Fine.
Respond to this and stop.
Yeah. Now, the lady professor, sociologist, was first question. About sensitivity of the judiciary. You highlighted some expressions and you said we can't confront the judiciary when they say such things, which reflects their mindset also. Even a progressive judge like Justice Kadju, apart from his other faults, but he's a progressive judge. He used the word keep in a judgment. Now, since the use of such language is a reflection of the judge's social philosophy, and since you can't remove judges except through a difficult impeachment procedure, all the more reason why we must know their social philosophies before they are appointed, and this can be effectively achieved only by outside participation. Then there was an observation really about diversity within the collegium itself. Taking perhaps your suggestion was that while you may not have a diverse selecting body, there is a diversity within the collegium which will ensure the diversity. I understood your observation and question as that won't that take care of it by itself? You're not.
Collegium is not a uniform body.
A three-judge collegium or a five-judge collegium is, in my view, a monolith. It may be diverse in a very, very, what shall we say, micro sense, that you might have a woman member, a Dalit judge might have made it to the top five, right? But that accident of momentary diversity in a momentary collegium, because the life of a collegium can be 3 months before that judge retires and some other judge comes. That kind of diversity is not sufficient for us to achieve the macro diversity which we are wanting to achieve. And you said, why can't judges be questioned more on this by civil society? After all, judges are being fiercely criticized. Yes, and of course, judges are sensitive to what is said on television or what they read in the newspapers. I don't discount that. But there has to be a democratically accountable institutional mechanism in the first place, and all these things can only be in addition. Performance commission, performance appraisal. Yes, you are right that mere establishment of an NJAC itself will not ensure a quality judiciary. There has to be constant performance appraisal. We don't have a performance appraisal commission. But by having an outside element, you will at least be ensuring that judges who have underperformed in their high courts are not brought at least to the Supreme Court merely because they are senior. At least to that extent, civil society and the law minister, if he is not in league with the judges, can question a judge's performance record. And you are absolutely right that against one kind of subservience, pliant judges, the collegium system demands a different kind of subservience, of deference. And this example was given by either the Attorney General or those supporting the NJAC. You will find a flurry of foundation stone laying activities in different high courts when the Chief Justice there is wanting, is aspiring to be elevated to the Supreme Court, because he wants to invite a Supreme Court judge on the collegium to come and have his name etched in stone. Junior Advocates Library SCC wing, or that's an extreme and exaggerated example. But this kind of thing happens. Visits to Delhi, some judges who have tried to call on collegium judges have had their holiday programs disrupted, and sometimes financial loss on tickets, because they thought they'll meet Justice so-and-so one particular evening and then they are booked to go to Port Blair the next day. But the collegium judge says, I can't see you today, I'll see you tomorrow. And so there goes the Andaman holiday. No, these are all, some are real examples, but these are only Now, I fully agree with Arun that what is creating, what is making people like him still reticent about roundly condemning this judgment is the reality which they are seeing. Now, you have given the Gopal Subramaniam example. Now, that was something which happened when the collegium was still in force. The executive did raise an objection, but if the judiciary had stood firm and reiterated its recommendation, under that dispensation the appointment would have gone through. So was this really something which should be blamed on the executive, or was it the failure of the judiciary itself? And you gave the example of Film Institute and a couple of other examples. The only difference is that there the government is the sole appointing authority, whether it's the Indian Council of Historical Research or Film Institute, or there was one more example that you gave. Yeah, no, ICHR, then this Gajendra Chauhan, there was one more example which was given. A censor board, I think, film censors, or, yes, that's right. But I don't think that example would really apply in a situation like this where the executive is one out of six. And I must clarify the ADM Jabalpur part. I don't know if it was my distinguished colleague Sudhish Pai who, in his article, which I have not read but which he has spoken to me about, I don't know if he likened the judgment to ADM Jabalpur as being equally disastrous. Did you, Sudhish? No, not. You said that. Right. You said that. Come to stay. My reference to ADM Jabalpur was a little more limited. I said Justice Chalameshwar's dissent is as significant as Justice Khanna's in ADM Jabalpur, though they were in two different contexts altogether, and Justice Chalameshwar dissented in favor of the executive, Justice Khanna dissented against the executive, but qualitatively I think both are of the same order. And finally, to the question about its being a recruitment problem. I'm glad you asked this question, because I'm known as a service lawyer, though I'm trying to forget my past, but I'm known as a service lawyer. Now, in service law, you have the appointing authority and you have the disciplinary authority. And normally they are the same. And Article 311 of the Constitution says, shall not be lower in rank than the appointing authority. Right? Now, the first fallacy in your question is in the assumption that the Chief Justice of India or the Collegium are the recruiters. They are not the recruiters. The recruiter is the President of India, either in consultation with the Chief Justice of India or in consultation with the NJAC, if it had stood. So the recruiter is someone different. It is not the judiciary. And that's the fundamental mistake which the judiciary itself makes in thinking that they are the appointing authority. Second point I want to make in this context, and I'm glad you brought this up, is if judges are removable only by parliament through the political process, with howsoever a difficult a majority it may be, 2/3, etc. If parliament is the removing authority, does it stand to reason that parliament, through the executive, can have no say whatsoever in the process of appointment? Thank you.
Ramachandran, that's a wonderful talk. I think while there may be dissenting thoughts in each of our minds, like Arun said, we're all enlightened this evening. Thank you everybody for coming here and spending 2.5 hours on a Saturday evening, I think. And with questions still waiting to be asked, I think that itself says that we've had a good weekend.
And can I also thank the audience, not only for their patience and for coming, but for absolutely brilliant questions.
I think we'll just hand over a small memento to Mr. Ramachandran for coming all the way down from Delhi to be with us. Thank you so much. I've been asked to tell you there's tea and coffee outside for those who wish to have it. I've also been asked to specifically thank Ramya and Kavya, who've done the details of putting this event together, and we hope to see you next year.